Who are you in this country? I'm Steve Storick, Ecumenical Staff Officer for the United Methodist Church. The absence is palpable of the historic African-American Methodist churches in this body, and the ecumenical movement purports, after all, to be a movement, but it has been expressed institutionally for decades. And things are hard to figure out these days where we are. But it is heartbreaking to me that we have CCT, but we don't have African American Methodist members in the historic African churches family in this body. And who knows where we are with the National Council of Churches or Churches Uniting in Christ. So either Jim or Congressman Lewis, you care to comment, I appreciate it.
Jim, I think you're in a much better position.
I think Steve is quite more able to speak to that one. CCT there. I know that's been a long conversation going on, but Steve, you want to speak to that?
Let me say that it is a long conversation, and we are pursuing that relationship with respect for each individual communion within our African-American family. We are not seeking to force anyone to join, but neither are we allowing our African-American brothers and sisters to ignore where we are in relation to CCT. So I would encourage you to pray for our outreach with them, and of course, feel free to communicate with them yourself in inviting them to participate with us.
Can I say, I'm very encouraged at CCT. The three issues CCT has taken on to start with are poverty, evangelism, and great racism. This was CCT. And I think that's the best way to start to bring people together. I mean, my notion of ecumenical, even interfaith involvement, is when we put ourselves, our feet into action. We were at the Capitol once for a budget debate, and we were outside the Canada office building, and we were people from different faith groups, and it was a rabbi who said, can I join you guys? And so I said, yeah, we're going to read Isaiah, so you can read the text. And all your men and women were looking out the window, and we were all praying, and we got arrested and taken to D.C. jail over the budget. And I saw this rabbi and Tony Campolo having this long in-jail conversation about Christology. Who is Jesus? Who is the meaning of Christ? And it was a good theological discussion going on in the D.C. jail. And I said, now that's how we should come together. Get arrested for our faith and talk theology in jail.
Thank you so much. This is just a delight to be here. Brother John, how are you? Virgil.
Fine. How you doing, sir?
All right.
Good to see you.
You and I were the youngest members on Martin's board, Virgil Wood. And I worked with Jimmy Carter establishing the National Co-op Bank. My question is, we are very lucid about beloved community, but there are those who understand that without a beloved economy, you cannot have a beloved community. Jesus said, seek the kingdom, I will give you everything you have been chasing. That's the economy. And I fear that the talk of beloved community is falling on deaf ears. Here we are 50 years later, and he says that what last thing Martin told him, as you know, was that if I have to give my life for this movement, I want to die among poor people, right? And then he said, I want to die for poor people. It seems to me that his agenda, and I beg to differ a little bit, that the letter from the Birmingham jail is the most important document. Maybe the Riverside a speech, or maybe even one of the sermons where he called a man, said, why did Jesus call a man a fool? Seems to me that we have abandoned Martin's economic agenda for the willingness to feel good about being with the So we have traded Martin's idea of equity for affiliation. I'd like to get your response to that.
Well, Brother Virgil, we're not there yet.
Right.
And this is not the end. This is just...
It's 50 years later.
Well, you know, yeah. Maybe 50 years sometime, it take a long time.
Not 100 people. Well, when people are hungry.
Well, get to my...
Yes.
I've always said during my early days, during my days with the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, and I said to my colleagues in the Congress, the struggle to build a beloved community, the struggle to redeem, as Dr. King would say, the soul of America, it's not a struggle that lasts for one day, or one week, one month, or one year, or one generation. You have to take a long, hard look and be consistent and be persistent and never, ever give up. But you must be engaged in the process. It's an ongoing struggle. So people ask me over and over again whether the election of President Barack Obama is a fulfillment of Dr. King's dream. I said, no, it's just a down payment. We're not there yet. There's still too many people in America. They're black, they're white, they're Latino, they're Asian American, they're Native American, that have been left out and left behind. They're Christian, they're non-Christian, that are suffering, not just in America, but around our world. And we're not going to complete the task. We're not going to complete the job. But there are others who come along and pick up and carry on.
We've got to have a better answer for poor people than we have. And to tell them to be satisfied with the beloved community when they're hungry and there's nobody, even the president is not even talking about poor people. And I think that I spent my time with Martin. And I know, and to the Zipanisha Irish wrestle with even during his time, and he told me that until we could match the beloved economy with the beloved community, beloved community talk is only talk. And we have to match our talk with our walk.
I think you're right, and remember, Dr. King went down to Memphis at the beginning of a poor people's campaign. And we haven't really gone back and picked up that mantle. Yeah, we should all read the Great Riverside Speech. Yeah. Vincent Harding has written about this again and again. And we want to freeze Dr. King in 1963. And that's not where he finished. He was talking about what I would call the uneconomy, unfair, unstable, unsustainable, making people unhappy. He was talking about that and military. He spoke out against the war in Vietnam, and most of the movement, many of the leaders of the movement were against it at the time because it would make Washington unhappy. But he spoke against the war in Vietnam. So we have to listen to Dr. King in 1965, 6, 7, and 8, and not just 63. And we have to listen to what he said. I think that's true.
Virgil, I was there at Riverside Church. Right. On April 4th, 1967.
Yeah.
And you don't become frustrated. Leaders must not become frustrated. You must not despair. Be hopeful. Be optimistic. Keep the faith. Keep your eyes on the prize. Keep pushing and pulling. Leaders must lead. If we as leaders of faith appear to be down and out and say, we're going to give up, what are we saying to the larger community?
If Dr. King were alive today, he'd be talking about, right now we have the highest poverty rates in this country in 50 years. He'd be talking about that. And the greatest inequality in this nation's history and less social mobility in America than in Western Europe. I know he'd be talking about that today in Social Week.
He'd be doing something.
Thank you.
I wear many hats, but to introduce myself, I would say I pray for myself and for all of us that we will become troublemakers for the beloved community. Thank you, Congressman Lewis, for your witness and for your leadership. And I come out of the Roman Catholic tradition, and I have a question for Archbishop Kurtz. And it concerns what Jim Wallace said about the fact that today, in the United States, we live in a nation that incarcerates people of color at a rate higher than apartheid South Africa. And you had said, Archbishop, that our church has offered, our bishops have offered many words of wisdom and insight from the gospel. My question is, from Dr. King's letter from Birmingham Jail, he speaks clearly about the challenge of calling racial groups who do not voluntarily give up their privilege and power, that is a nonviolent struggle. Nonviolence includes, I think, for white people, unlearning our complicity in racism in America. And I'm asking, when will the U.S. Catholic Church do the work of calling people and helping people to undo our own racial privilege?
Well, thanks for giving me, first of all, the chance to respond to that. I would agree with you that restorative justice, which is what I think the bishop's document has talked about, needs to be put into action. That document that we issued was, when I first became a bishop, was in 1999 or 2000. It was one of those 2 years. And we need to work, first of all, in community. We know that. And you know that, too. I'd love to be able to say that we as a Catholic community on our own can make a difference, but I will say this: in the Commonwealth of Kentucky, where I serve, we're working hand in hand with many people. And you're absolutely right that there's a pastoral presence that I think is a very important spotlight and witness. In 2 weeks, I'll be celebrating Mass in Marion Correctional Adjustment, they call it Adjustment Center. And also on Thanksgiving, on Christmas, and on Easter itself, to celebrate Mass or prayer service in a correctional facility. Now, why is that important? I think it's important because we need to put a spotlight on the reality of what's happening. Our efforts, I think, as a first of all, to support legislation, is there, it's documented. Do we need to do more? Yes, but we need to do it in partnership. There's no question about that. So I would agree with you. I think people are hungry to reach out, especially to people who are incarcerated. I agree with you. Thanks.
All right, yes, sir.
Reverend Esteban Lugo with the Christian Reformed Church. I guess, and mainly to Reverend Jim, I struggle with the issues of racial injustices and racial, how should I say it, economics that continue to happen in the church, where we have various people of color constituencies. Because of the system that exists in many of our churches and denominations that basically pits one ethnic group over, pits one against the other for financial support or economic support. And so It's a system that is competitive. Rather than developing this, you know, this beloved community that we're talking about, where the various people of color constituencies are standing together, you know, supporting each other, we don't see that very often. How can we address this? Because there is, within the church, racial divide that continues to happen, but it's a system, it's systemic. How do we address that? How do we deal with that? So that we can move on and become that beloved community.
Another period, and I assume we'll get in trouble with someone, but it'd be good trouble, necessary trouble. Back in another period, 50 years ago, I remember so well, President Kennedy invited a group of us to the White House. This is leading up to the March on Washington. And President Kennedy didn't like the idea of a March on Washington. And he said, if you bring all these people to Washington, won't there be violence and chaos and disorder? We would never get a civil rights bill through the Congress. And A. Philip Randolph, so Dean of Black Leadership, labor leader, civil rights leader, spoke up and said, Mr. President, in his baritone voice, there's been orderly, peaceful, nonviolent protest. So we left that meeting with President Kennedy, went out on the lawn of the White House, and we told the press we're gonna have a march on Washington. And a few days later, we met in New York City and invited four major white religious and labor leaders to join us in issuing the call for the March on Washington. It was a coalition of what we call a coalition of conscience. And the religious community was well represented. Protestant, Catholics, members of the Jewish community, and Walter Ruther of Organized Labor. And when I see the film and the photographs from that day, there were churches, people from different religious organizations and groups from all over America. And we can do it again. I'm not saying another march, but we can build a coalition of conscience, a coalition of faith. So why not this group? Can I get out there and do what Lyndon Johnson said? Make me do it. Why can't we make a president do it? When Dr. King received the Nobel Peace Prize in 1964, he came back to Washington, had a meeting at the White House with President Johnson. And he told President Johnson, we needed a Voting Rights Act. And Dr. King said, we don't have the votes in the Congress to pass a Voting Rights Act. I just signed a Civil Rights Act. You're going to make me do it. And we went to Selma. We intensified efforts. And Dr. King made an appeal. And 2 days after Bloody Sunday, more than 1,000 religious leaders, priests, rabbis, nuns, ministers came. And sometime we have to move our feet. We pray, we get up and move our feet. We have to find a way to dramatize. People used to ask me back in Nashville during the 60s, what should we do, John? I said, we need to find a way to dramatize the issue. Put a face on it. Maybe we need to go to Kentucky, go to Mississippi, spend time in Alabama, in Tennessee, where people, in the urban centers of our country, where there's hunger, where people not getting enough to eat, not receiving a good education, not receiving health care. We have to put a face on it, dramatize it.
I think in the letter that King wrote to answer your question, he says, there was a time when the church was very powerful. In the time when the early Christians rejoiced at being deemed worthy to suffer for what they believed. In those days, the church was not really a thermometer. They recorded the ideas and principles of popular opinion. It was a thermostat to transform the mores of society. Small in number, they were big in commitment. We don't take the witness and history of the early church seriously.
Yeah.
When they took that Galatian passage very seriously, and it was a baptismal covenant, pattern of the world. When we let the world squeeze us into its mold, what happens? We reproduce the racial and gender and class divisions of our culture. And what happens there is nobody, we're not any longer evangelistic. Why should anybody care what we're saying? But what we're doing is the same thing that others are doing around them. So we have to take the early church's example very seriously, and it was a racially and gender and economically transformational community. And that's, I think, King had it right. That's where we have to go back. When small in number, they were big in commitment.
All right, Brother Don Williams says he showed me a zero. And I believe that means stop. Let's give a hand to all of our panelists. Come on, thank you so very, very much. We will turn the conclusion of our symposium. If you be seated for a moment.
How you doing?
Brother Carlos is coming.
I'm doing fine. I'm doing fine. Okay, you come
in. I would like to share a few announcements with you. I would also like to say a few words of thanks to several groups of people. And also, I would like at the end to invite you to join us downstairs where we don't have a lavish feast, but we have some refreshments that you can participate.